Zynga Milanov, what for you makes a beautiful voice, a beautiful artist?
The production and the way, you know, she's phrasing and the way she's attacking. For instance, for me, is the most important thing, a beautiful piano, because without piano we cannot sing, you know, but many do. But I personally appreciate very much piano, and I was very much loved for my pianos, you know. Naturally, you must have forte, you know, that goes together, you know. But the way you attack the music, how would I, you know, I'm going to be now very professional, you know, and like a real maestra di canto. But, you know, the phrasing, you know, for instance, in Aida, you know, there are so many, many famous things. And I'm very proud to say about my Nile Aria, the recording, you know, which you probably will play, you know, I hope you will.
Yes.
As I said, this is a very difficult opera for a singer to do the perfect job.
Now, it's one thing to get a beautiful piano in a recording studio. How do you do it in a large opera house and have people in the back
row
here?
That is standard for me, always. It was standard. Every performance, you know, when you listen my recordings, I mean, the recording over the radio were taken so many, you know, of Aida. I was all the time singing Aida. For a while, you know, there was nobody but Zynga, you know, singing Aida. Which, you know, it's not so easy to do. On the tour we had, 1 year we had about 15 Aidas, you know, so on the tour. Beside that, I sang other performances of Trovatore and so on, you know, but this makeup and all that, it's not so easy.
But still, how do you control the voice in such a way that it can be soft and travel at the same time?
The quality of the voice is very important, and the way you produce and the way you support, that's how it comes. You don't have to sing loud, you know. In the old house, you know, the acoustics were not so good, but they always said that you could on the last row of the balcony you could hear the pianos, you know. That is important, you know. The piano is extremely important to be well supported, and the piano must be just as good as the forte. I didn't say less forte, I said piano.
I asked Zynga Milanov about her teaching and about the elements she tends to emphasize most in her work with young artists.
You know, I worked all my life and always was controlling my voice, and somebody always watched me. And that is very important, what most of the singers don't do. You see, they go out and they just like to make money and sing a performance, and that's it, you know. But there are some wonderful singers, you know, we have. As I said before, I listened to a couple of very good performances, you know.
What I'm getting at, I came up studying the piano, and I think instrumentally, I guess. And when a pianist, or a violinist, or a cellist, or whatever, gets to be 22, 3, 4, when he begins his professional life,
yes. Mm-hmm.
Under normal circumstances, he does not anymore take lessons. He may play his program over once in a while, but that's as far as
it
goes.
That's the answer on what I said before.
Well, but why do singers, why are they different? Why do they need coaching? Why did you say, you one of the greatest artists ever, why did you need to be...
You don't want me to be naughty.
Why not?
Well, some people are afraid to study, to be told that they have to do this or that. So they don't want help.
But go back to your own situation. At the height of your career,
yes.
Were you studying? Were you coaching? Were you working with someone?
Always. Always. I had my brother who was watching my voice all my life, you know. He was older. Unfortunately, he died. And after that, I stopped singing, you know. 2 years after that, I stopped singing. And I must say, you know, that was very, very sad, and but it was a great, great thing to have him, you know. Not everybody has that. My brother was musician, pianist, composer, and special good coach, and he was watching me. Many times he came, watch out, Zynga, don't do that or this, that, you know, don't be too wild or something, you know, because you sometimes you are tempted on the stage. especially in Aida, or you know. And if you have something very difficult to sing, for instance, an aria, like for instance Nile aria, that's, you have many soprano who don't want to sing Aida just for that Nile aria, for that famous high C, you know. But I don't think that the high C is only important. Important is also the middle of the aria, and everything is important. That's what is a real artistry, you know, when you watch every tone, every phrase, every bar.
Now, how can you watch every tone, every phrase, every bar, and at the same time be a personage, be a character on stage, act a part, and run up and dance and whatever else?
You have to be born for it, you know? That you have to be born for it, you know? That you have to be born to be a singer, or to be an artist, violinist, whoever it is, you know? So that must be you. That is the personality, you know? So that's also is very important. When you have a difficult aria or a difficult phrase, you have to watch before. Naturally, you can't move, you know. And when you come out and you sing "O Patria Mia," there is not much to do. Or when you have the Trovatore, for instance, you know, there is, when you come out and sing the Morsulari Rosé, you know, and there is nothing you have to do. You just stay and give the best you can vocally. Because there is nothing, the more you move, the worse it is. There is nothing you have to do. You know, you just have to sing beautiful.
What about some of the conductors that you worked with at the Metropolitan and elsewhere? What did you look for in a conductor?
That's the same thing like you ask about the singer, you know, or about instrumentalist, you know. You have to, the conductor is only good if he feels what he's doing with the singer. Because like a good coach or a pianist, you know, for instance, for a recital. You know, you have to have somebody who feels you. If he's a wonderful pianist, that's not enough. You know, you have to feel the singer. That's the same thing with the conductor. If he is conducting and not watching the singer, I never had trouble. You know, I must tell you, Mr. Sherman, you know, I never had any difficulties with any the conductors. I was in my approach always very modest, and I think this is a big virtue to be modest. You know, and that's why I always study and I worked and. I was a purist, you know. I believed in beauty, you know, of singing, you know, and this was my way of doing it, you know. But we, unfortunately, during my career too, but right now, you know, you don't hear so much anywhere this kind of beautiful singing anymore. Here and there, you know, you hear a performance of Pavarotti, who sings beautiful, and he also, look at him, when he has a big aria, nothing bothers him, you know, if somebody moves. He goes and he stays in his way, puts his hands together and sings the whole aria, without moving, without doing anything. And I tell you, a vocal personality is much more important, vocal message. That's what makes a good singing, you know, I mean, approach to the public.
So do you think that the modern trend toward, well, let's say, more acting and more dramatic stage presence and all of that has detracted from the art of singing itself?
The dramatic does not come from lots of movement on the stage, you know. The real approach to the public, it's much more important if you give a vocal. That's why I'm mentioning Pavarotti. Because he, when he has something to sing, you know, and when he has to approach a big aria, you know, he watches himself, you know, and he says, here I am, and here I'm going to give you my best. And that's the way it should be. Vocal message is very important. That comes first. And then comes movements. They can say whatever. I remember I had all kind of critics, you know, they said that... you know, I didn't move too much. Sometimes get away with acting if you can do vocal good job, you know. The whole thing has to be combined, you know, naturally. But if you act too much, the phrasing cannot come, especially if it's something difficult. You have to watch your breath, you have to watch your, the whole phrase, you know, you cannot cut in the middle in account of your running around or doing too much, you know, and cut off a phrase in the middle or something like that, you know. Naturally, you have to have experience, you have to love what you do, and you have to be smart when you do your job.
How much of the smartness that you just referred to is in the hands of the singer, and how much is given over to the conductor and the stage director and all of the other people who are involved? You have to be your guardian of your own smartness.
Of course,
then.
Of course. There are lots of times, you know, that the orchestra is too loud. And when I started to sing in the Metropolitan, you know, when Mr. Bodansky was the one who engaged me in Europe, and I was frightened, of course, you know, this is without any question. But he had a feeling that I was trying to give more than I have. And he says, you sing the way you usually sing. Don't give more. Don't be afraid of the big house, or don't be afraid of the orchestra. You just do your job the way you always do. Don't force, don't be impressed by the big house, you know. And that's what sometimes people do. Maybe because they feel that, I feel the more you force, the voice doesn't carry over the footlight. A most beautiful small piano comes, you know, well focused, you know, this comes, you know, out in the house like a bell. But it has to be a well done, you know.
Cinco,
a
what,
real good piano.
For a non-vocalist like me, what do you mean by focused? How do you, we understand it when we hear it, whether it's clear or fuzzy, but in terms of producing, in terms of singing a town, how would you tell somebody to focus it?
Well, you have to show. That's why when I'm giving lessons, you know, I'm showing how to do it, you know, because I don't believe in master classes.
You don't?
Personally, I don't. I think each artist or each young singer has to be shown exactly and produce the sound by the teacher. That's my personal opinion. But you know, I might be wrong, you know, but I see that this master classes, you know, that's a big show, but I don't think the artists can, they are told, you should do this, you know, but they don't show them how to do it and make them, you know, some people have tremolo in the voice, so vibrato, and that has to be, you know, erased, you see, this is very important. This is breath control, and
each thing, each one of these elements has to be personalized. It has to be focused on the particular person,
sure,
particular
sure.
singer.
Yes. I had lots of singers, you know, young singers when I was in the Curtis Institute, you know, and they were good voices, very good voices, and I was very impressed, and I wanted to show them, you know. So I said, come, and, we'll, you know, this was, it took me 2 years to one singer who had the most beautiful voice, you know, 2 years, you know, to get out of the throat, you know, the tremolo she had. 2 years. Sometimes, you know, I was so tired, you know, that I couldn't have my dinner. It's very hard job. And the teachers, they don't work like that, you know. There are a couple of singers I would be very happy to show you. I won't mention any names, you know. They have good voices, but they don't use the way they should sing, you know. I mean, they don't use the voice. They have a good sound,
right.
But it's lots. They lack lots of things, you know, and they should be shown. And legato is the most important thing, you know.
One last point, Cinco Milanov. You mentioned earlier that you sang at the Met for 29 years. There are so many singers who arrive with great publicity and great excitement, and they sing for 4, 5, 6 years, and then we lose track of them.
Maybe
they're gone.
Maybe only 1 year.
That can happen as well.
Yeah.
What, to whatever extent you can verbalize it, what did you do that enabled you to have such a long career?
The most important thing is that one singer should sing and should know the limit, which part to sing. because to just to sing to get a beautiful opera to sing is not good. You must sing what is good for your voice, and many singers, many and most of them are trying to do more than they should. Mm-hmm. You see, you should stick to your repertory and be nice and quiet when it comes something to you know, that I was asked for so many times, you know, to sing Strauss and to sing Wagner, even at the time of Mr. Johnson. And my brother said, never. You should not. I have done in Yugoslavia, Elsa in Lohengrin, and Tannhäuser a few times in my mother tongue, you know, Yugoslav. But I never did here, you know. And I don't know if I would sing Turandot here. I sang in South America, and I stopped, and that's it, you know. And I never would sing Turandot here, for instance. And there are lots of opera that I refuse.
You know, it's funny. Just recently, I had a discussion with Montserrat Caballé, and she said almost exactly the same thing, that you have to turn down roles. She did not come to the Metropolitan for 2 years because they didn't have the operas that she felt she could do well.
Yeah, but she's one of the beautiful voices. You know, I heard her when she came, you know, to United States, her first concert in Carnegie Hall. That was a very beautiful voice, and her her piano was compared, and she used it, you know, with mine. You know, she used it in her throwaway and the publicity and so on. And she loves me very much. You know, we just met, you know, in the Metropolitan, and she kissed me, and she was appreciated very much, you know, my singing as I do hers, you know.
Well, I think we all appreciate your singing, Zinka Milanov.